Today we're going to be taking a look at visual field defects as part of the clinical neurology series. The best place to start with this topic is by first understanding how the normal visual pathway functions with a simplified diagram. So as you can see here, we have our two eyes and we have the visual field in front of them. At the back of each eye, we have the retina, and this retina can be divided into two main parts. We have the temporal retina on the sides and the nasal retina at the center. One important concept to understand is that light rays from the center of our vision hit the temporal retina. In other words, the temporal retina is responsible for the nasal or central visual field. And at the same time, light rays from the outer vision hit the nasal retina. In other words, the nasal retina is responsible for the temporal or outer visual field. This is a very important concept to understand, as it makes things a lot easier when thinking about defects. Now, when light hits the temporal retina on one side, the impulse is carried via nerve fibers to the thalamus on the same side, and a specific part of the thalamus called the lateral geniculate nucleus. And this happens both on the left and on the right. However, when light hits the nasal retina, the fibers actually cross over to the contralateral side. And again, this happens both on the left and on the right. You can see that there's a point where both of the nasal retinal fibers actually cross over, and this is called the optic chiasm. Any nerves which are before the chiasm are referred to as the optic nerve, and any fibers after the chiasm are referred to as the optic tract. But the main takeaway from this slide is that the nasal retinal fibers cross over at the optic chiasm, whereas temporal retinal fibers stay on the same side. Here we have another way of illustrating the visual fields instead of drawing all of the light rays. You can see that we have the inner semicircles which represent the nasal visual field and the outer semicircles which represent the temporal visual field. Let's now start by taking a look at each type of lesion, starting with an optic nerve lesion. And just to clarify, a lesion can be defined as anything which disrupts the flow of signals from one part of the nerve fiber to the other. So for example, this could include strokes, tumors, compression, or any type of trauma. So in this case, we're going to start by looking at the left optic nerve lesion, which affects the upper part of the diagram here. The way of thinking about this is by looking at which lines are affected. So in this case, you can see that the blue and the red lines are impaired. If we trace the blue line up, we can see that it corresponds to the temporal retina on the left side. And as a consequence, when this is disrupted, we lose the corresponding nasal visual field in the left eye. At the same time, you can see that the red line is also affected, so we lose the nasal retina of the left eye as well, and subsequently the temporal visual field. This results in a left anopia, so the entire left eye is unable to generate an image. In exactly the same way, when there's an optic nerve lesion on the right-hand side, we can see that both the green and purple lines are affected. So if we trace the green line up, we can see that the temporal retina is lost, and therefore the nasal visual field is impaired. And at the same time, tracing up the purple line, we can see that we lose the nasal retina in the right eye as well, which means we lose the temporal visual field. This would result in a right anopia in this case. So summarizing an optic nerve lesion, this will always lead to an anopia on the same side of the lesion. Let's now take a look at the second type of lesion, which is an optic chiasm lesion. This affects the region where the nasal fibers cross over. And as you can see here, both the red and purple lines are affected. If we start by tracing up the red line, we can see that it corresponds to the nasal retina in the left eye. So if this is lost, we lose the temporal visual field in the left eye. In other words, it results in a left temporal hemianopia. At the same time, if we trace up the purple line, we can see that we lose the nasal retina in the right eye as well, and subsequently lose the right or temporal visual field in the right eye. And again, to summarize, that would be a right temporal hemianopia. Based on both of these changes, an optic chiasm lesion would lead to a bitemporal hemianopia, and this can classically be caused by a pituitary adenoma. Moving on to the third type of lesion, here we have an optic tract lesion on the left side, which affects the lower part of the diagram. Using the same principle, here both the blue and purple lines are affected. So if we trace the blue line up first, we can see that it affects the temporal retina in the left eye, and subsequently, we would lose the nasal visual field in the left eye. At the same time, if we follow up the purple line, we can see that we'd lose the nasal retina in the right eye, and therefore lose the temporal vision in the right eye as well. Based on both of these changes, we can see that an optic tract lesion on the left side leads to a right homonymous hemianopia. In other words, we lose the right visual field in both eyes. Again, using the same process, if we had a right optic tract lesion, we would lose the temporal retina in the right eye, and therefore the right nasal visual field, and at the same time, we would lose the nasal retina in the left eye, and subsequently lose the temporal visual field in the left eye as well. This would overall mean that a right optic tract lesion leads to a left homonymous hemianopia. Where it starts to get slightly more complex is when we have to start thinking about the visual fields in terms of quadrants as opposed to halves. And the reason why we have to do this is because we can extend our original diagram to show the primary visual cortex. And we have fibers which reach this cortex both on the left and on the right hand side. These fibers are collectively termed the optic radiations, and each radiation basically codes for one quadrant of the visual field. If we start by taking a look at the orange line first, this represents the left inferior retinal fibers, which traverse through the temporal lobe of the brain. And one way of thinking about this is by tracing up the lines. So you can see that the orange line is connected to both the blue and purple lines respectively, which both code for the right visual fields in both eyes. The only part you have to memorize is that the inferior retinal fibers code for the superior visual field, so there's an inverse relationship. Combining both of these factors together, the orange line would code for the right upper quadrants in both eyes. Using the same logic, we can take a look at the green line, which represents the left superior retinal fibers, and these run through the parietal lobe of the brain. Again, we can see that the green line meets both the blue and purple lines, so it's going to code for the right visual field once more. The only difference here is that the green line represents the superior retinal fibers, so it's going to code for the right inferior visual field instead. It's exactly the same on the other side of the diagram, so the brown line represents the right inferior retinal fibers. By tracing up the lines, you can see that the brown line meets both the red and green lines, so it's going to code for the left visual field in this case. Because it's an inferior retinal fiber, it's going to code for the left superior visual field. This leaves the pink line, or the right superior retinal fibers, to code for the left inferior visual field. Let's now take a look at an example where we have a lesion in the left inferior retinal fibers. Going back to first principles, we can trace up this orange line and see that it's meeting both the blue and purple lines. This means that the right visual fields in both eyes will be affected. And since this is an inferior retinal fiber, we're going to lose the upper right quadrants of each eye. In other words, an inferior optic radiation lesion will lead to a right-sided superior quadrant anopia. Using the same thought process, if we have a lesion in the left superior retinal fibers, this line is again connected to the blue and purple lines respectively, so they contribute to the right side of the visual field. In this case, because it's a superior retinal fiber that's affected, it's going to result in the loss of the lower right quadrants of each eye. In other words, a superior optic radiation lesion on the left side will lead to a right-sided inferior quadrant anopia. Taking a look at the other side, we can see that a lesion in the right inferior retinal fibers would affect the brown line. And this brown line is connected to both the red and green lines respectively, which means that they contribute to the left side of the visual field. Because this is an inferior retinal fiber, the upper left portions of both eyes are going to be affected, resulting in a homonymous superior quadrant anopia on the left side. You can work through the final example to show that a right-sided superior retinal fiber lesion will lead to the loss of the lower left quadrants of both eyes, or a left homonymous inferior quadrant anopia. As long as you can draw the original diagram, and remember the inverse relationship between inferior and superior visual fields, you can work out which types of defects are present for each type of lesion, instead of having to memorize them all individually. And here we have a diagrammatic summary showing the different types of lesions and their corresponding defects. I hope you found this video helpful, and I'll see you in the next one.